Good evening, brothers, sisters, friends in Christ. A special welcome to you all and a very special welcome to anyone joining us for the first time. Thank you so much for answering the call on your hearts to fellowship with us today as we seek to deepen our understanding of God's word in what will no doubt be another exciting and enriching Bible study session. I am Keisha Melhado-Forrest of the Church of the Transfiguration, and I'll be moderating this evening's study. Now, we can't have a session about God and not invite him to be a part of it. And so before we begin, we will ask our brother Clive Heslop to lead us in prayer.
Good evening, everyone. Heavenly Father, as a consequence of the ingenuity with which you have endowed mankind, we are able to come together in this virtual fashion. Notwithstanding the physical separation, our deliberations continue to benefit from your loving kindness that never fails us. We thank you for those who have joined us and pray that you would guide our thoughts and actions to bring you glory. Strengthen us and fill us with your peace. May we love and serve each other as Jesus has shown us. Fill us with the Holy Spirit to do your good work here on earth. Heavenly Father, you are worthy of all honor and praise. Help us to love as you do and to act wisely so that others will be drawn to your salvation and hope. May we build each other up and encourage each other today as we give you all the glory. Gracious Father, thank you for this opportunity to be transformed in your presence, heart, mind, and soul. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Clive. Thank you. You can always be relied on to leave no stone unturned. Okay, so this evening's session marks the midpoint of our 11-week study under the theme, The I Am Who Meets All Our Needs. For those who may be new to the study, there are three sub-themes, basically one for each month. So we started with God Introduces Himself in May, where we covered the topics, I Am Who I Am He, and Truly, Truly, I Say to You, Before Abraham Was Born, I Am. Now for the month of June, our sub-theme is God Reveals Himself, part one. So far, we've covered I am the bread of life and I am the light of the world. And this evening, we'll be looking at I am the door of the sheep, which will be led by Pastor Bruce Polson. And then we'll end the month with I am the good shepherd. And we'll round out the study with the final sub-theme, God Reveals Himself, part two in July. And I'll share more about the topics to be covered in the weeks ahead at the end of the session. I now invite us to listen to a meditation piece.
I want to know you. much more than I do. Learn to seek your face, and the knowledge of your grace. I want to love you. I want to serve you, Lord, much more than I do. I want to serve you, Lord, much more than I do. Learn to seek your face, and the knowledge of your grace. I want to serve.
Thank you, Mitzi. A lovely meditation piece. All right, so as I mentioned before, our presenter this evening is Pastor Bruce Polson of Christian Life Fellowship. He's no stranger to us, having led a few of our studies in the past. I believe this is his fourth time with us, more than enough time for him to be considered family. Welcome and thank you, Pastor Bruce. Over to you, Pastor Bruce.
Thank you. Thank you, Keisha. Okay, good night, everyone. Good night. Thank God for giving us life, health, strength, another day. And it is my pleasure to be sharing with us tonight. You know, as I reflected on this passage, that I will focus on today, where Jesus says, I am the door. I think that we would have gone through some things, been going through different revelations of God in Jesus Christ. Jesus declares himself repeatedly as the I am in several ways. I think in the book of the writings of the Apostle John in the Gospel, we see about seven of them, if I'm not mistaken. And in this one, he says, I am the door. And the message is not lost on the disciples, on the Jewish leaders, as if when we read the scriptures, we realize that they were constantly aggravated and annoyed and upset with Jesus as he declared himself repeatedly to be God on earth. But this particular passage, wow, this is like really rubbing it in their faces in the sand. I'm not going to read it, but in this passage cannot be, I'm going to go back to this one, let me just go. It cannot be interpreted without understanding that Jesus was in fact using a contrast to emphasize who he is and what he came to do. In John chapter 9, the previous chapter, and I trust we may know that the Bible was not written in chapters, so it was a continuous flow. But for our sakes, it's the translators try to help us by putting in chapters. But we see in John chapter 9, there's a man who was blind from birth, and he is powerfully healed by Jesus. Now, I think if most of us saw somebody healed by a minister, born blind and healed, we would be so excited that, you know, it was, the man would be over the moon and his family and everybody would be just in a state of excitement. What we saw instead in chapter 9 is that the religious leaders, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, took the man to task. They interrogated his family. You know, is this really him? Was he really blind? You know, you will see where the mother, the parents were afraid of these guys because they had power. And they said, well, you know, he's a big boy, you can ask him. And you see the interrogation that they put the man through, and it, you know, the man said, boy, you know, this man healed him. And he said, and they were saying, you know, well, you know, sinners can't heal you. And the man says, well, I don't know if he's, you know, all I know is that he healed me. So what you see is that their main concern was the protection of their image and their status. And Jesus used this illustration of the sheep, shepherd, doorkeeper, and door to hit back at them and to expose them as frauds. They were more interested in themselves than in the welfare of the sheep. But he's not like that. He's a real deal. Now, just to underscore the point a bit, without reading, I think most of us know the story of Lazarus. Is that a reasonable assumption? In John chapter 11, you can say yay or nay. Lazarus had been sick and died. And by the time Jesus reached Bethany, the home of Lazarus, he was dead and buried 4 days. And Jesus raised him from the dead. So whilst in John chapter 9, we see where the man who had been born blind was interrogated by these leaders, in John chapter 11, now it gets even better, because now we have a man who was dead and he's raised from the dead. And, you know, everybody was excited. But when some of the disciples of the Pharisees went and told him what happened, they said that, boy, this is not looking good. They decided that, you know, they have to do something about Jesus, because everybody's believing in him, and they need to take him out. And then we see it gets worse in John chapter 12, verse 9 to 11. Not only did they decide that they were going to take out Jesus, but they were going to take out Lazarus as well. And Lazarus, because he was the living witness of the miracle of Christ, I would encourage us to read Matthew 23. That's one of those passages in the New Testament where we see the anger of Jesus Christ as he lambasted the religious leaders. You know, seven different woes. Woe to you, woe to you, woe to you, hypocrites, and so on. And Jesus, spoke about their hypocrisy and lawlessness, their greed and self-indulgence. You know, they were uncaring of the sheep. And he really lambasted them. I would also encourage you to look on Exodus, Ezekiel 34, now, which is the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, you see where the God lambasted the shepherds of Israel. And again, the whole thing was that their concern, their interest was for themselves, for benefiting themselves and not the sheep. So in this context, Jesus then, you know, he gives this illustration. He's saying to them, not only is he not like the Pharisees and the shepherds of Israel, he's saying, I am. And we will see, he says, I am the door. And we'll see more about that. So he's saying, he's not like these guys. He's a real deal. And you will see that because he's doing an illustration, we have to be careful how we take every point from the illustration, because you can miss the point of what he's making and be stuck on some little individual itty-bitty points where it may not necessarily match up. So if I could, let me just see if I can go back. Perhaps somebody could read this for us, John chapter 10, verse 1 to 10.
I assure you, anyone who doesn't enter the sheep pen by the door, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. The doorkeeper opens it for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought all his own outside, he goes ahead of them. The sheep follow him because they recognize his voice. They will never follow a stranger. Instead, they will run away from him because they don't recognize the voice of strangers. Jesus gave them this illustration, but they did not understand what he was telling them. So Jesus said again, I assure you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep didn't listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. A thief comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come so that they may have life and have it in abundance. The reading of God's word.
Amen. Amen. Word of God. So Jesus is the real deal. So what is a door or a gate? We know it's a point of entry and exit. Okay? Jesus repeatedly, the interesting thing was that he pointed, when he rebuked the Pharisees in Matthew 23, he described them as things like blind guides. He described them as hindrances to other people entering the kingdom. They were obstacles to people's progress. He said they made the burden of people unbearable. They added laws and interpreted laws. It is said that Jewish leaders, they had a set of teachings, which were interpretations of the law. Now, the Jewish law, I think, has something in the region of about 600 and odd laws. They created something like 100,000 laws from this, because they had multiple interpretations and little bits and bits and pieces added in. But they were obstacles to people entering the kingdom. But Jesus says, he is the door, he is the gate. And so that tells you that he essentially determines who gets in. But in summary, let me just give some summary points and then we'll discuss. Can we see from the passage, can we agree that Jesus is the one who determines who gets in?
Confirm,
right? But the beauty of this Jesus, not only does he not get in the way or hinder, it says that he is the doorkeeper. He is the one who enters first. So we follow him in. He leads us in. He's not an obstacle like the Pharisees. He's not one who is making life difficult. In fact, Jesus is the one who said that we must come unto him, take his burden. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. He is the one who says, follow me. In John chapter 14, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except he comes through me. But he is inviting people to come through him. Okay? So Jesus is the one who leads the sheep into the sheepfold. Right? But the good thing is, I find too, is that he doesn't just lead us in. He secures those who get in. That's something that struck me as I spent time looking on the passage, that it's not just about us getting in and saying, we made it, and boy, you know, it's a nice place in here. No, it is that he secures us in this place. So, you know, you're not going to just get in and be easily lost. That is, to me, a really powerful thing, that Jesus not only determines who gets in, but he secures those who get in. The next thing is that those who enter legitimately won't regret it. They are blessed with eternal life. So he leads the sheep in, as John says. John 14 verse 6 says, he is both the one, point number four, who enters by the gate. He is the legitimate shepherd of the sheep, unlike the Pharisees, unlike the false leaders. It says, those who come, those people are robbers and thieves, but I came that you may have what? Life, and have it all in abundance. So this doorway, this door of the sheep is giving access, unlike the Pharisees, unlike the religious leaders who put burdens on the people and misled them and were more interested in their own welfare and, you know, their status. This shepherd of the sheep, this leads us in and is determined to benefit us. He says, I came, unlike those guys, those who are before me, I came that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So this doorway, the pasture, is a doorway into life, abundant life. I want to go back a little. Let me see, to the passage, because so he goes in as in verse 2, he's the shepherd of the sheep, he leads us in. The doorkeeper, now the shepherds would have understood this. This is agrarian society. They would have understood, because what used to happen is that the shepherds would pay somebody for access to a pasture land area. And they would pay this doorkeeper, and so multiple shepherds would have access to the same pasture area. And they would pay the doorkeeper to let them and their sheep in. Okay? But Jesus is himself the doorkeeper. So he says, the one who enters by the door is actually the shepherd of the sheep. The doorkeeper opens it for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name. They listen to him and so on. But we see where the sheep follow him in. They recognize his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, leads them out. So in this illustration, Jesus is presenting himself as the one, the only one who can give genuine access into the real pasture. Okay? So when he gave this illustration, it's verse 6, he said, they didn't understand him because, you know, Jesus was using contrast. He was making the point that these guys are no good. I am the real deal. So he then makes it abundantly plain. He says, verse 7, I assure you, see me, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers. So he now takes off the gloves. He's not hiding it anymore. And then he says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he'll be saved and come in and go out and find pasture. A thief only comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come so that they may have life and have it in abundance. The interesting thing I observed here is that I don't know if you see it, that once the sheep have entered the fold through the door, that's Jesus himself, they actually have complete freedom to come and go. I don't know if you saw that. He said, once they're in, verse 9, if you enter through Jesus, you will be saved, and you can come in and go out and find pasture. So there is a security in Christ, which is not, it's not as restrictive as if you compare what the Pharisees and so did, because what they did, their emphasis was very much on control. They controlled the people. And if you needed to get any information, it must come from them. Everything went through them. They went as far as to reinterpret laws. A classic one was when the law said you must honor your parents. And that meant material honor, not just respect, but material provision for your parents. The Pharisees, so they reinterpreted that created another law which said that you can actually choose to give what you intended to give to your parents, to the temple, and this wickedness. Right? I would like to emphasize the point that when we come into the kingdom through the doorway, right, there is an abundance of benefits, an abundance of benefits that is available to us. And you see, the beauty of the kingdom is that no one person controls anybody. We have a personal relationship with the shepherd. It's not just entering into an area. Jesus is not just he doesn't separate the fact that he's the doorway, the door into the pasture. He says he's the door for the sheep. Jesus is really leading the sheep into a relationship with himself. And that means that you and I that is why we are able to experience abundant life. It's not just about coming in and following a bunch of rules, but it is coming into a relationship with the real shepherd, the real deal. And this shepherd gives us life. And this life, yes, eternal life begins from now, but it is fully accomplished when he returns and establishes the kingdom of God. I believe one of the best reflections of the abundant life is seen in Psalm 23. And so I had that here, which I thought we could just look on. It says, the Lord is what? My shepherd. There's nothing I lack. He lets me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He renews my life. He leads me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even when I go through the darkest valley, I fear no danger, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Only goodness and faithful love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord as long as I live. I believe this is a beautiful picture of the abundant life. So even though we have in the Christian context, in the Church of God, we have leaders, we have shepherds, but these shepherds are different from the chief shepherd. The scripture refers to Jesus as the chief shepherd. We are brought into the kingdom. We enter the kingdom through the door, who is Jesus Christ. But into this kingdom, we have a living, vital relationship with the shepherd. So those who are ministers, priests, shepherds, whatever we call them, are beneficiaries of this grace, but so is everybody else. So this is not something where the shepherds restrict the kind of fellowship. This is not something like the religious leaders of Israel were, where the shepherds are preventing the sheep from experiencing the benefits of the kingdom, or putting barriers in front of them, forcing them to come, and you have to go through the hoops that I set up. This is something where we are introduced to a relationship with the chief shepherd that we call it abundant life. He says, even when I go through the darkest valley, you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me. It says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. I don't know how we see this one, but when you are elevated in front of your enemies, in a human sense, it's like, we're saying, kind of like a child who is showing off and saying, obey. I don't know if people still say that now, but in the presence of my enemies, our shepherd elevates us. He elevates.
Pastor Bruce?
Yes.
Two things. Yes, people still say obey. And secondly, yes. Jacqueline has her hand raised.
Go ahead, Jacqueline.
Yes, Pastor. I remember the abbe in primary school. I don't know if it's still used here.
But, dating ourselves. Mm-hmm.
But what happened? While you're presenting, a contrast keeps fighting its way into my mind.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have created a vision
mm-hmm.
of a secured, defined space called the green pasture. Let's call it the kingdom, a defined space.
Mm-hmm.
But then I'm thinking about the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and in my mind, I'm just seeing bundles and bundles of sheep in confusion. Because you're saying that the Sadducees and the Pharisees created these situations for the people to access the good of life. And some of them themselves are not even carrying out following those guidelines. So I don't know if it is that my mind is trying to wrap itself around how the sheep managed prior to Jesus. Because in my mind, I'm seeing confusion, hard mm-hmm. work, a lot of unnecessaries, contrasting now with the door. And this new dispensation, as mm-hmm. evidenced by this pasture with peace and lying down and rest, so contrastingly different from pre-Jesus' time. But it's just that the images that are conjuring up in my mind. Mm-hmm. I'm just seeing these bundles of sheep in stress.
And I would agree with you, because I think in Matthew chapter 9, at the end of that chapter, you know, after Jesus had gone through an extensive time of teaching and preaching and healing the sick and doing all sorts of wonderful things, it said he turned to his disciples and he said, you know, these people are like sheep without a shepherd. And you see, it is like if you're looking through the eyes of Jesus, you're seeing what you just mentioned. You know, trundles of people, confused, overwhelmed with all sorts of things. And instead of, you know, life, what they're getting is difficulty. More and more things being put upon them. And, you know, Jesus came and he said, ask the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into the harvest, because these are sheep. The analogy of sheep and shepherd is one that keeps coming up. You know, in Isaiah 53, I think it is, he says, all we like sheep have gone astray. Turn everyone to our own way, and the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. And so you see this thing where Jesus, the suffering servant, bears the suffering of the sheep because of our own disobedience. And that's the basis on which he gives life. But he does not, instead of putting up burns in front of the sheep, he lays down his life for the sheep. He makes a way in the realest sense. He is the doorway into God's presence. He is the door into all that God has for us. You know, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. And, you know, of course, there's an implicit warning in that, because we can choose, rather than going through the door, we can choose to find another way in. And Jesus says, if we do that, we fall into the category of robbers and thieves. Why would you? I don't know if this analogy carries any weight here, but, you know, I like to think of back in the days, you know, there was football and different sports activities at the National Stadium. And, you know, we used to go to the stadium for these activities, but there were some guys who got into the habit of what we call beating it into the stadium. So they'd be always climbing the wall to get in. And the funny part was that there were times when the event inside was free, but they were still trying to beat their way in. And so in this sense, you can have, I can see kind of similar situation where there are people who were so accustomed to the burdens and the restrictions that the Pharisees put on them that they couldn't see that the way into the kingdom was by faith in Jesus Christ, simply put. You know? Take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. Believe on me. Ye believe in God, John 14. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, many mansions, many rooms. If it were not so, I would have to. I'm going to make a way for you. And you have persons say, no, sir, that's too easy. That sounds just too easy. That sounds too easy. There must be something. I have to earn my way. And so And we know that there's a difference between a person being saved and doing good things because they're saved. I believe when we are saved, God expects us to do good deeds. Agree? Amen? But we can also be trying to add our goodness as if we can help God. So Jackie, you had I'm seeing your hand now.
Please. Yes, Pastor Bruce. In those verses that I read initially, there's a part that says Jesus goes out and the sheep follow him. And I'm trying to understand in what context, because one would think that once you go through the door, you're in, you stay in. Why then would you go out? Verse 4.
That's verse 4. Yes, right.
Verse four.
Well, it's interesting. If you look on verse 7, I found my way back to it. It says, Jesus said again, I assure you, I am the door of the sheep. And one commentary I read pointed out that Jesus didn't say he's the door of the sheepfold. He says he's the door of the sheep. And the comment, I thought it was an interesting comment by the writer. He was making the point that the focus of Jesus is on the sheep. So if the sheep, the key thing in this passage is that the sheep are following the shepherd. So wherever the shepherd goes, the sheep are following him. So the in and out is not an expression of a physical location where this place you are in, this place you are out. So you're going in and out, in and out. It is more going about with him. Having gone through the door, having been brought into fellowship with the shepherd, the sheep experience freedom, but the freedom comes as they follow his voice. So we can't discount that aspect where he says, they will never follow a stranger, verse 5. They will run away from him because they don't recognize the voice of strangers. If we look at verse 9, it says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will come in and go out and find what? Pasture. So it's not coming in and going out of the pasture, but by being connected to the shepherd, following the shepherd, as we go, we'll go in and out. And that's kind of like the priestly blessing, which says, the Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face shine upon you. You're going out and you're coming in. It's more an expression of traveling than exiting the pasture and going somewhere else. I don't know if that makes sense, but let me let Keisha speak first and then I'll...
Thank you, Pastor Bruce. And after I speak, I will share some comments in the chat. So when I read further along, because I had a similar question to Jacqueline, when I read further along in the chapter, John 10, verse 16 says, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. And just in thinking, I know it might be too literal and it might be an oversimplification of what we're talking about, but in terms of thinking about sheep in several pens, at some point, in order for them to all be together, we're going to have to leave the confines of the pen that we were in. I don't know if that is also part of it. Jean's comment in relation to that is that if they stay inside, they won't get any food. And so they won't get any food.
I saw Jean's very practical point. Yes.
Because the pasture is outside of the pen. But I was just also thinking about the verse which followed about the fact that we're not all in the same pen. We're all going to have to come out and we'll all be together, one flock, in one pen or God's kingdom. That's how I read it. All right. Go ahead, Pastor Bruce.
No, I was just going to say, that the tricky part when you start, because you're dealing with an illustration here, there are points when the analogy can break down.
Mm-hmm.
So like, as Jean rightly points out, the pastor is out. The issue is that it's not a case where there's some restrictive room that the doorway leads you into. You go through this door and you're into this room. It really is a wide open space. It suggests that if there is space, there's an abundance of space, there's abundance of provision, and there it is that the shepherd is giving access to the sheep, giving the sheep freedom to explore the pasture. Eh? So I haven't read the in and out as a in today, out tomorrow, but as I said, for me, my understanding of the going in and out, the come in and go out, is kind of idiomatic expression. So I interpret it as an idiomatic expression. The come in and go out speaks to traversing the pasture, traversing. So I was alluding to this blessing that God gives, that the Lord bless you in your coming in and your going out. It speaks to life. It is not a restrictive physical location.
And so Pastor Bruce, in response to that, Jean had said she loves the idea of security, which is not restrictive.
Right.
And Marcia had her hand raised a few times. Marcia, I don't know if you still wish to contribute or ask your question.
Well, I was thinking the part first about the relationship thing, you know, the sheep going in through the door, that there is structure. The sheep know where they're going and they kind of know what's expected of them. They have that, and they have the security. They know that when they get into this pasture, there is no harm because they have got the shepherd, the good shepherd. And there, as you said, there are benefits, whatever is there for them. And you mentioned Psalm 23. And then I was thinking on the other hand of the sheep, with the analogy with the Pharisees, that here what you've got is, and it spoke of it, to the confusion, which is like a master-servant relationship where one, you know, they're lording it over and you can mistreat. And I thought about when the disciples had asked who'd be greatest in the kingdom, and Jesus reprimanded them, you know, and reminded them of how the rulers of the Gentiles, how they lord over, lord over, you know, they've got this, it's very strict, very restrictive, and there is no intimacy, the kind of relationship into which the sheep would be entering with the good shepherd. That's not there. There is a barrier. There is we and they, and you had better behave. You have to follow. And then I came down to verse 9, had been puzzling me, probably still puzzled. He will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. And so I thought about Jesus saying, other sheep I have were not of this, is it fold? And I must go and bring them in. And that where Jesus goes, he has a door, there is pasture. And I thought too about the Great Commission. Honestly, I don't know if this scripture that we're reading came before, but the idea that now the sheep have that security, and the sheep, therefore, as people, say we have I don't know, sheep have a mission, but in the sense of where we go, you know.
Yes, why? You know that
no, okay, really, I see the link you're trying to make.
Yes, so we have to create so that pasture. And so we are there because we have that security. And Jesus is out because he's not staying in one place. And so the don't think I explained as well as it. I have it in my head, but in that sense that we're not just going to go in and stay there, but we can go out. The freedom that says where we go, there is pasture, because it's like Moses, where you stand is holy ground. And so in that sense, amen.
Okay, let me just allow Jacqueline and then I'll comment on that, Mercy.
Okay, thanks, Pastor Bruce. I love to spend time on YouTube, and what has been becoming very popular is persons trying to give people a way that is outside of Jesus Christ for peace and joy. And I'm saying, oh my God, because if Jesus says he's a door, then all of those people who are pushing a different agenda, I'm kind of sorry for them, because they are using their own self to achieve what is not possible. And so it's as if they're doomed to failure.
Yeah.
But it is such a popular thing. There's one about a monk who gave up his car. This guy Sharma or something. And when I heard, there's a gentleman named Sharma. But what happened? The point I'm raising is that these are proponents of another way. And it's heavily into meditation and other areas. And I'm saying it is like you're setting up people to fail because they're not going to be able to reach that level of satisfaction and peace and joy without Jesus Christ. So it's rather sad. Just an observation.
Thank you, Jackie. The thing is that, just to underscore the point about the pasture, the whole idea is that Jesus being the door cannot be divorced from the fact that Jesus is also the shepherd. He's using an illustration. He has said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. So this thing, this doorway is a doorway into God through Christ. So the pasture is not a physical location. It is a place of fellowship with God. And so I just wanted to underscore, I mean, you know, if I learn anything new, I'll say, but my understanding of the expression come in and go out is that it is an idiomatic expression which speaks to in one's travel. The whole point is that when we come through this door, this door is taking us into fellowship with God. That is why Jesus came. The saddest part, as you said, Jackie, is that here is somebody, God has made a way into his presence, and they are choosing another way and not realizing probably that by choosing another way, they are essentially rejecting the way which Jesus Christ has provided. And as you say, doomed to fail. It's kind of sad. So you alluded also to the point about, I think you were trying to make a connection of the sheep being on mission. I would just make one comment here. Jesus had a way of making, could I call it a kind of spiritual, political message? So he would, when he said, I have sheep that is not of this fold, he's underscoring the point to his Jewish listeners that he never just come to save Jews. He come to save all. And you know, this is something which they are hearing, but they don't yet get it. They will eventually. That this shepherd, this door is not just for the Jews. He's not just a shepherd of Israel. He's a shepherd of all who believe. So I just wanted to throw that in. I see Noreen with her hand up.
Yes, good evening. I was thinking that the relationship of the sheep to the shepherd is really illustrating to us the difference in lifestyle, being with Jesus as against being with under the leadership of the religious teachers. And for me, a good comparison is slavery and freedom. And I noticed freedom was mentioned several times in the speaking earlier by you, by others. In that working as a slave, one is being burdened, being forced to do what one often has no desire to do. And this creates stress, discontent, resentment, and lots of other negatives. While when one is free, as the freedom that we see being expressed there, when one is free to engage in activities which one chooses because they enjoy that activity, then there's often motivation and joy, fulfillment, and psychological contentment. And that this is what the abundant life that Christ is speaking about would bring to us. So I just thought that slavery, working under slavery, working as free to choose, for me, shows being the sheep in the guidance of Christ as a shepherd, as against being there following the leaders that I think is Jackie just spoke about, who have right. their own selfish agendas.
Yes, that's a good point, Noreen. I think I would make the segue here to the fact that the worst suffering that we have is that again, using the sheep analogy, in Isaiah 53, verse 5, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to our own way. And so in this case, the only difference with the slavery here is that while slavery was imposed upon us by another ethnic group, in this case, the scripture points to the primary source of slavery as us going astray and becoming perhaps the worst slave master is a slave master of disobedience to God, because it promises us that, you know, if you go this way, kind of like Adam and Eve, where Eve looks and says, boy, that looks good. And if I eat that, it will make me wise and I'll be like God and so on. And then when they do, it brings sorrow. And so perhaps the worst kind of slavery that mankind is under now comes from the fact that we are living our lives outside of the control of the shepherd. We are trying to gain what can only be gained by yielding to the going through the door. So Jesus is in this context when Jesus says, a thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Contrast, I have come so that they may have life and have it in abundance. So the sheep, the sheep, really. And he uses it. It's interesting that he uses the term sheep, because what I've read, I'm not a sheep rearer, but you know, some people have told me that sheep, they're kind of daft. And you know, they depend very much on the shepherd. And so there's a kind of thing where, in order to go through the door, we really have to humble ourselves and turn to the shepherd of our souls. And so, you know, it is Jesus being the doorway, the door, Jesus being the shepherd. There is a beauty to the analogy that, you know, he's really saying, when you go through the door, when you come in through me, you are saved and you can now benefit. You can go in and out and go in and out and get pasture. There is a beauty to it when you contrast it with the what lies out there, whether it be that slavery is imposed upon us, or whether we realize that we are enslaved because of our own disobedience. This shepherd offers freedom. Offers freedom. He offers freedom. And just last point, I would just say, let's not lose the point that, as Jackie said, there is an exclusivity about following Christ that a lot of people don't like, but that's the truth. If he is the shepherd and he's the door, to go any other way is doomed to fail. He's the real deal. This is the section I wanted us to, you know, we have said it. Eternal life is never ending. It's high quality. It's in the presence of the Father. And Psalm 23 is a beautiful, you know, prototype of it. It begins now, but it only finds completion when Christ returns and the kingdom of God is established. And we see it in John 14, verse 1 to 3. Jesus says, your heart mustn't be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. And he makes the point, my Father's house, many dwelling places. I wouldn't have told you if it wasn't so. I'm going to prepare a place for you. If I go away and prepare a place for you, I'll come back and receive you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. So it is... This whole thing is, we are being called into a fellowship with God. That's what we're being called into.
Pastor Bruce, Jean has a comment in the chat. Exclusivity with inclusivity. One way to life, open to everyone.
Yes. Exactly. Yes. Exactly. Thanks for the reminder, Jean. That is true. That is so. So I was, you know, in my, not exactly idle moments, but I was just thinking the other day that I'm somebody who wants to tell everybody that there's someone who died for everybody, so that anybody who believes in him can be saved. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Bruce. I was about to ask if anyone had any questions or comments. I see Jackie's hand raised.
Yes. I was just saying that it is very sad that we look at Psalm 23 and see all of the benefits to those persons who come through Christ Jesus into this relationship. Mm-hmm. And there are so many people in the world who need it. They need it so badly. They need the direction. They need some sheep vision, people. They need support, and they just seemingly don't know that they can access it. So unless somebody, unless they come into us an environment like this Bible study that allows them to see that, hey, there is a way, there's a solution, there's a better life. Because a lot of us are just going through life as automatons, just being cast through and fro by the issues of life and not realizing that there's a better way through this door, Jesus Christ. So just a little plug that each of us, even though we are sheep, we do have a mission, because it would indicate selfishness if we are living the good life, in quotations, and we see people around us who need that good life, and we say nothing to help them.
Yeah.
My comment.
Yes.
Thank you, Jackie. Pastor Bruce, if you wanted to respond, please go ahead, and then I will share what's in the chat. And
I saw Marcia's hand raised. No, I will say Marcia has something. I will.
Oh yes. I was thinking this, and then when I think it's Jacqueline who spoke, what she said made me think of more of it, that what is offered to is a sort of family relationship. We come in, you know, the good shepherd, we're led into this pastor, we are protected, we have that security. And I think about the spreading of the table, the provisions and so on, and more so even the security, I think family, that what we come into is this kind of a family relationship. And as Jacqueline was saying, that there are persons who really need, you know, they're out there, they probably feel alone, they're experiencing all kinds of maybe emotional disturbances and so on. They don't know that there is another way. And that, to me, there is this family. What happens when you come in? You become part of a family. And, you know, you don't exist unto yourself anymore. And you can actually share and be helped in that sense. You've got others to rely on. More so, you've got the good shepherd, Jesus, on the offers. Amen.
Amen. I think that is something which is that we certainly in our church community, one of the things we have been encouraging ourselves in is the need to share our faith, to share the gospel, to encourage people to come to Christ. And it is, in particularly in just the conversations of life, you know, today I went to a pharmacy to buy some, I was buying some painkiller, something to put on, I have a back issue. And I was kind of joking with the customer service person, saying, you know, if you don't have any spare parts, spare body parts. And she was laughing and saying, no, if she did, you know, she would get some extra for herself. And, you know, kind of took the opportunity to just, you know, say to her that, well, the good thing is that if you know Christ, if you know the Lord, we can look forward to the resurrection. And we had a brief conversation about that. And, you know, that's something that strikes me, that, you know, we can have conversations with people and even be prepared. Sometimes our window may be a window of a few minutes. We may have the opportunity to say, can I pray for you or pray with you? And, you know, that is the, you know, yes, we are sheep on mission. It's an interesting link to make in terms of sheep of another fold. It's broadening it a little, but it does if it can help us to see ourselves as, you know, laborers, as sheep on mission, yes. That's something we can use.
Thank you, Pastor Bruce. Okay, just sharing some comments from the chat. Beverly says, and we should remember that Christ also said that he has other sheep that are not of this fold. John 10:16. The important thing is that they listen to his voice. And then Jean goes on to say, my second takeaway is Psalm 23 as a picture of the abundant life, right. Deep. And Essie, we cannot enter unless he draws us. That's Essie's comment.
Okay. If I would comment on that, I would say that since we don't know so many things, we never know. We let us try not to miss opportunities, just to share a word of encouragement, a word urging somebody listen to turn to Christ. And we never know. You know, it is very often through a word that is said. As he said, he sends persons to preach. It is through something, us sharing God's word with somebody, that the Holy Spirit could be in our hearts and minds. So I would just remind us of that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Pastor Bruce. I think we have 10 minutes before we end. So Jacqueline, I think, has her hand raised, and then we'll close out the segment.
Thank you. The story will take about a minute and a half. Just to show you how you have to be prepared for when the Lord directs you to speak to someone. Mm-hmm. I am parked at Megamart at 11 p.m. one night, waiting for my daughter who's inside. Parked to my left is a taxi man, and I presume he was waiting on a client who was inside the supermarket. I'm getting upset now because I want to go to my bed. It's 11 o'clock. So I decided I'm going to head into the supermarket, even though I didn't think I was appropriately dressed, to find my daughter to haul her out. I'm walking past, and I hear a voice in the taxi that says, "Lady, you're a Christian?" I paused, and I said, "Oh my God, I'm going to have to stop." So I turn around and I said, "Yes, how can I help you?" Here's a taxi man who's been searching for God, reading his Bible for the past 2 weeks. And he needs to know how to become a Christian because he's right now at the point of tears. And so on my way to the supermarket, I'm stopped in my tracks to witness to this man.
Wow.
And so within less than a minute, I walk him through the sinner's prayer and then tell him that he needs to find a church, etc., etc. And it dawns on me that I'm going about my merry business, and the Lord just say, "Hey, you have a work here. You need to deal with it." And so at the end, by the time I finished speaking with him, my daughter returned from inside and I was able to go home. But just to raise the point that you have to be prepared. And it is not quoting scripture. It is not bringing down Jesus off the cross. It is simply meeting a person's need where they are.
Yeah,
I think that's it. Yeah.
Thanks. Amen. Praise God.
Praise God indeed. Thank you so much, Pastor Bruce, for this evening's session. I've been enlightened, and although I have read this passage before, I really didn't process it the way I probably should have. So thanks so much for breaking it down for us. He is the shepherd of all who believe. He is the door to the sheep, and the pasture is the place where we can find fellowship with God. Thank you so much. Pastor Bruce, at this time, I'd like to ask you to just reinforce the study with prayer. And yes, at the end of the session, I'll ask you to do the benediction as well.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Let us pray. Oh God, our Father, we thank you so much. Thank you so much for Jesus Christ, who came and took upon himself all of our sins and all of our pain and suffering, and he bore it all on the cross so that all of us who believe in him can be saved. We can enter through the door. We can come to you, God and Father, through Jesus Christ, the door. We can come in, we can be saved, we can come in and go out and find pasture. And Lord, as you have reminded us tonight, Lord, we can also be sheep on mission. We can help to bring other sheep in. And so, God, I pray that you would strengthen and encourage us. And Lord, as we, I pray that you help us to regard that relationship with Christ as precious, something to enjoy. Lord, help us to never lose sight of the fact that you came that we might have life, abundant life, and that we can share it with others. And so, Father, I pray that you would cause your word to be fruitful in our hearts and minds tonight. I thank you for the opportunity for us to just learn from you, to hear from you, to benefit from your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Bruce. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to round out this session with our closing song. You are awesome in this place. Please feel free to sing along with your mics muted and let the words speak to you.
God, you are awesome.
Amen. Thank you, Mitzi. All right. Thanks to everyone who contributed to this evening study, those who provided technical support and prayed and presented the or read out today, those who actively participated, and for those who simply joined and listened. Now, next week, we'll be covering the topic, I Am the Good Shepherd, and that will be led by our dear sister and friend, Dr. Jean Lee. And then following that, we would now have entered the month of July, so we'll be starting our third and final sub-theme, which is God Reveals Himself, Part 2. And that will cover, the topics to be covered then are, I Am the Resurrection and the Life, I Am the Way, the Truth and the Life, I Am the True Vine, and we'll, as we customarily do, we will close out the session now, the series, with a time of prayer, reflection, and response, which will be led by our prayer team. Now, we look forward to seeing you all next week and for the remainder of the series. And please, please continue to invite persons to join. I think we had upward of 80 persons today, which isn't bad. We need to get that number climbing. Let's try for 100 next week at least. And please invite a friend or two. Remember that the platform can accommodate 500 persons, so we have more than enough space, right? Thanks again for joining, and take care until we see each other next week. Pastor Bruce, the benediction, please.
Okay. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, equip you with everything good to do his will, working in us what is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. All right, have a good evening, everyone.